Good morning. I was really hoping no one would come. So, yeah, but we'll get through this. So, the plan of today is how to plan art. My name is Dan Falta. I've been in the industry for, I don't know, what is that, 1997? So, I have seen things with people who are not believe. Like Roy attach ships off the shoulder of Brian. No, but really, it's been a ride. The game art is a special beast. It's the newest form of media, basically, if you discover VR, which is actually just getting started. And it requires a very, you know, specific set of skills. Let me switch this off. Just a second. How do I do this? Anyone know what this is? Yeah, I can see that. Basically three parts. The first one will be a little bit of history, also, you know, my personal experience. Then we'll talk about how to, you know, plan art, how to, you know, break down the project, how to outsource, how to set up the pipeline, run the production, and specifically how to run your team, how to talk with artists, and how to get to the finale successfully. When I started in games, I didn't know how to do any art. I only know how to hold a pencil. But, you know, that didn't, you know, prevent me from actually working on a game. I think it was 1997 or something like that. It was an RPG crawler. And I was supposed to do the characters. So I used this, you know, classic Disney animation, you know, technique where you have this, you know, underlit glass table. And you superimpose the frames, right? And you draw a frame on top of each other, so then we digitize it and put it in the game. And call it everything. But after that, I realized, you know, if I wanted to stay, I needed to learn, you know, how to do digital art. And I'm learning still, you know, it's. So, this is Bong. What is this? Yes, very good. I'm only showing this, you know, because those are the stepping stones that the video game arts took in the last 40 years, actually. Like I said, it's very, very new, part of the human creativity. but 16-bit Amiga. Sorry, I remember I used to go to a friend of mine, and he had Amiga, and when I first saw that, I was completely blown away. I had those kind of epiphanies, you know, a couple of times. I think after that, when I first saw Wolfenstein with this fake 2.5D and then Quake. Well, now we're about here. Because 40 years, one of the founders of Pixar, I think Alvin Ray Smith, said in 1997 that reality is 80 million polygons. Are we there yet? Not yet, right? How many polygons can we actually show in the view in real time? A million? It's not that many, right? Regular assets like vehicles have been 40,000 triangles or something like that. Characters and stuff. So yeah, we're, you know, taking some ways around that. I think one of the crucial years was 1997. The SIGGRAPH of 1997, where a lot of solutions were presented. For example, normal mapping, which basically gave rise to the AAA titles. It became prevalent around 2002. And after that, you know, it spread all of these, you know, big studios and great titles, and also it raised the budgets massively. Like, what's that? Let's look at Assassin's Creed as an example of a AAA game. The first two instances were done by a single studio, Ubisoft Montreal, while the fourth one, the Black Flag, had to be broken down between 8 studios. $100 million of costs. So that actually, you know, signaled the emergence of the game industry, you know, on top of film industry, because right now the game revenue is actually higher than from the movies. Alright. Enough history talk. So how do you go about an art plan? Well, I would argue for pre-production. I know, it's not very popular nowadays because we have all those, you know, iterations and basically this way of, you know, trying out new things and trying to get it right. Which I think, you know, came really from game jams. But pre-production, in my view, is a great thing, you know, because it gives you an option to basically test your proof of concept. So if you start with game mechanics and you build on top of that, you get to answer a lot of questions. A lot of studios will not do that because they consider that to be a waste of money. They would rather, you know, spend the money on the content or, you know, something like that. But actually, you know, production is, you know, massively important, because when you're done with it and you're going into production, there is very, very few questions to be answered. So what is pre-production about? Well, what kind of target audience we're going for example? It's really important even for art, because is very diversified. If you look, let's see, for example, into the Western region, or Europe, or Asian region, different kinds of things work with the local audience, right? And that, you know, comes like with everything. Color palette, animation, the general themes. So what you don't want to do is basically omit this, because then you really don't know what your target audience is, right? So I think it's totally worth the money to you know, spend the time with the pre-production. Anyway, it's a thing that really came from the film industry, and it's just from my own personal experience. Whenever I was working on a project where there was no pre-production, we had to solve all those problems later. But the main difference was that those were not connected problems like they would be in pre-production. No, because in pre-production, you look at the thing from all angles. Like, for example, does the art style fit into the general theme of the game? How do we go about level building, asset protection? Are we going to be outsourcing? What's the budget that we're working with? How do we go about that? Because, as you know, whenever you're doing any kind of project, you need to have some kind of leeway, right? So, if you're planning for a project that will take a year, be sure that you're going to overshoot that by at least 3 or 4 months, which will reflect on the budget, right? So all of that can be answered, you know, in the pre-production. So basically, when you finish, you should have at least 2 documents coming out of that, which is game design document and art bible. Art bible is not, you know, oh, I forgot to introduce Mr. Doodle. That's our host for today. He's a bit shaky because I drew him on the phone. Art bible nobody's nobody, you know, I think. Again, live reproduction is starting to be not used that much. I don't really think that's a good idea because our Bible, you know, contains very, very crucial questions, you know, or you know, information in terms of your whole visuals. Color palette, for example, you know, color palette works differently, you know, for different moods. Camera, atmosphere, what kind of atmosphere you're going for, what kind of style, how to go about abstraction, what you're looking for, you know, in the visuals to be the cornerstone of the project, right? So, Art Bible is a great thing, and also it's a great document, you know, of the project that you can later reuse for other projects. And this is especially important because, you know, documentation has a great value for future project, because there is a turnover in the company, and with those people that you lost, this knowledge goes away. this actually costs you money. All of those things are, you know, expensive to find out, expensive to develop. So I would always argue to keep the proper documentation. There is also another thing, which is, you know, introduction of people, of new people to the team. I mean, you don't want to be running around all day long trying to explain, you know, where's the project coming from, what you're looking for. You want to the people to have access to this trove of data that you already established, you know, because it makes things easier. Nowadays, usually, it is done in the form of, you know, Wikipedia, something like that, which is easily available and trackable. So, so that's all right, but it's absolutely important to keep it. You'll be surprised, like some studios that, you know, produce photorealistic-looking games, they think that there's no need, you know, for an art Bible. Because everyone knows how reality looks, right? I really had that quite a few times with big studios. That's completely wrong. Some cornerstones, you know, should be set down, because otherwise, what's going to happen is that in the end, there's going to be no integrity. And that's exactly what you going for, you know, visual integrity, because that's what's gonna, you know, attract players who will play a game. So what is this? Yes. All right. So ideally, when at the end of pre-production, we have those documents that we can build our plan on. Ideally, it should span across the whole production. So right now we already know, for example, how many people we actually need to have for the scope of the project. How many resources we need, how much stuff we really need to outsource, and what are we actually willing to pay for it, because we already know what kind of style we're going for, and not every, you know, kind of art is of the same costs. So let me give you a concrete example. When I worked on Race Room, which by the way is a Swedish game, originally from Syndicate Studios, we had to do a track. Anyone else what this is? It's the Asian Las Vegas, Macau. So basically, every year there is a race, WTCC race, that's taking, you know, part in the city. It's a little bit like what I'm coming, you know, because you have this hilly area. And the cars, they go, you know, through the harbor, then they go, you know, up the hill, and then, you know, back to the harbor. So basically, when you're up the hill, you can see the whole area of the city, and, you know, the whole ocean stretch and everything. So so we had to, you know, somehow plan that, and it's 6 kilometers of buildings, basically. So how do you work with that? Hundreds of buildings, most of them unique. How do you even plan how to do it, you know, from the technical point of view, for your game to be able to take it, to run it? Right? Well, obviously, first you need to know your, you know, tech specs, but in the beginning, we didn't really know if, you know, this is possible at all. So basically what I did was I broke down the track in three parts, you know, just to somehow, you know, make it more more feasible. We asked one of the guys who was living in the area to take, you know, photo references to track for us. So he went around, you know, by foot and took hundreds of photos. Put into sections. We basically divided the whole track into three tiers. The first tier would be the buildings right next to the track. Then there would be a second tier, and the third tier would be, you know, the faraway buildings that are not that important. Some of the buildings, you know, are landmarks, like that signal over there. So after that, we already had a list of the buildings we wanted to do. It was about 100 buildings. So for the first year, we were looking for some kind of visual fidelity, something that you have, you know, more detail in the model. For the second year, we're just going for simplified versions, but they had to be obviously in the correct position. And the third year, we could use a bit more general buildings, because no one would be going for that kind of accuracy. That would be way too costly, and also it would not be possible to do technically, because the texture would get too high, basically. So we had a team, you know, just a bunch of artists. I broke the work down between our team, and we outsourced a bunch of the buildings that we wanted to look the best from the first year. And in-house, we actually took care of the loft, the road, the track, terrain building, asset placement, and the buildings from the second and third tier. The outsourcing studio took care of, I think it was around 40 buildings, something like that. And it took us 6 months to produce this. I think in the end, got quite all right. Let's try and play the video. I'm not really sure if this is going to work. Let's see. So that's a comparison. Below is the PC version, and above is the live version from the real track. So as you can see, everything is possible if you know how to basically attack the problem. Breaking down the whole bulk of work is totally crucial. With any kind of project that you're doing, it is important, even if you're not outsourcing, to do prototypes. By that, I mean final assets, final scene, and the final quality. And if you really can do it, which is the best way, it's best to do vertical slice, which is basically just a functioning part of the game, let's say one level, with all the base game mechanics, everything you can put in, even effects, everything. Again, it's a proof of concept, and it will help you greatly, for example, if you're pitching the game to an investor or a publisher. And on top of that, it will help you to pinpoint problems that you may have in your design, as in visuals or game design, and then you basically, do according changes. Thank you. Oh, so we're in the production room. So we're all good, right? There's gotta be a bunch of things that we know. So the, a lot of things that would happen during the production room that are totally unpredictable. And that is why you should be prepared the best from the very beginning, because like otherwise it's gonna be a violent and well paid. You're gonna see, there are a lot of you will encounter, technical problems. For example, you may find that you overshoot with technical estimations from the get-go. So you will have to optimize later or something like that. But and of course there's the social dynamics, which are completely inevitable. But in general, by this time you should have your team already set up. You should know what's who's good with what, because team is always, ideally a group of complete, individuals that are just aiming for the same goal, but no two artists are the same. It's up to you to realize that and to somehow use that as well as possible for the project and for those artists, because some people are more technical, some people are more artistic, some may be not really interested in the project, they may be interested only in the art, and you just have to somehow, work with them. Outsourcing is a big thing nowadays. It kind of makes sense, because I mean, who would want to do the same chair over and over again? so that's why we have these services, and it's crucial for you to realize what kind of outsourcing you're looking for, based on your budget, based on the size of the project, based on the kind of style that you're looking for, because obviously heavily stylized visuals are tougher to outsource unless your documentation is great. Great studios, they don't usually like to outsource crucial things for a project, like let's say level building or lighting or even animation. But there is plenty that you can outsource, props, vehicles, characters, cutscenes. I mean, look at what Blur did for Blizzard. Imagine all those games from Blizzard without Blur cutscenes. They help them immensely. But be clever with outsourcing, because if you're going for big companies, let's say Virtuals got 1,000 people. They're doing a lot of projects, or soon you're going to be paying for their massive organization as well. If you're running a smaller project, you may want to, for example, put together your own outsourcing team. Let's say find the people that you think fit with their talent into your project, and get a guy who's gonna basically take care of them and supervise them. Nowadays we have a lot of platforms for them, like ArtStation, for example. Lately, this year, one of the studios I used to do some work for, they approached me because they were doing this heavily stylized game with these cartoon characters, and they wrote me and they're like, "Are you available?" So yeah, go for it. We need to refactor, remodel completely like 84 characters. I was like, "Really? Who do you think I am?" I mean, this is not possible to do it with one person. So, so I went to meet them and I explained that this is just not possible. And they were also very limited with the budget. You know, they only had something like 13,000 euro for 84 characters. Every character is more than 10,000 triangles, and heavily stylized. Everyone's completely different, so you can't really reuse anything. So I met them, and I just listened to them, and then I told them, you know, this is not possible. I mean, you have way, your budget is way too low. Your time budget is almost impossible because it was like 4 months. And so I don't think you can do this. But if you want, we can try it. And they said, all right, let's try it. So I found some artists on ArtStation, basically we put together a team, and they're finishing the project now. So they actually made it for this kind of budget, which is interesting. But the point of that is that the community of artists is very big, and I'm totally against this. You know, sometimes you get this approach like, we can, you know, give you exposure. You know, if you do this for us for free, you know, fine. Then I mean, like, art is expensive. It takes a lot of time. It's very demanding to do. You burn a lot of energy, so you should get paid. But obviously, if you're a newcomer to the industry, you will not get paid as a senior as much. But you should be, you know, proactive and try to work on commercial projects to understand the needs, right? Because there is a lot of, you know, digital artists that don't know how to do game ready model, don't know about, you know, how to basically work with the mesh so it's animation ready. They don't know how to optimize, they don't know how to unwrap, you know, basic stuff like that, because there is really a lot of, you know, digital artists that don't really need it. You know, maybe they work for, you know, movies, stuff like that. So ultimately, the community of artists that are experienced with game art is not that big, you know, globally. So, you know, it's always good to hone your skills, I think with the outsourcing, we have, you know, great opportunities now, and it's definitely a way to go. I'm actually running too long already. Are you bored? Should I finish? Alright, we're almost at the end, so I promise not to keep you too long. Keep an integrity, what do I mean by that? Stuff like naming conventions. All that boring stuff that, you know, everyone, you know, hates to do. And, you know, like, you know where you're at with the project, you know where everything is, right? I got the textures here, I got the textures there, right? You know? But in real life, it doesn't really work. You know, basically, any given project through time will get so big that there's got to be some kind of organization. You need just, you know, you need to keep it. It makes, you know, it's boring, but it makes complete sense, especially when you start adding, like, you know, third party assets to the projects, you know, stuff like that. It gets completely messy. I have to say, you know, like, worked for a lot of studios, and I have still yet to see completely clean project, because at any given moment the project is going through phases, and, you know, people are leaving. You get those situations like, you know, yeah, you know, our, you know, technical artist, you know, set up the project this way, and but he's gone now, you know. I mean, we don't really know what's going on. That's the reason, you know, why to basically keep some kind of order. Also work in a non-destructive way. Non-destructive way is something that will enable you to go back and do changes. Like, for example, with the texture creation, it used to be, you know, before it used to be just Photoshop. So, like, you would get all those massive PSD files, you know, half a gigabyte, you know, with 120 layers. No one would know what's going on, right? If you needed to do any change. I mean, right now we have, you know, great tools. I don't know. We have, you know, Substance. We have Pixel. We have, you know, different kind of, you know, versioning systems, SE and everything. You know, it makes sense to get the best out of that. You know, like whenever you know, submitting any kind of new data into the project, just put in the known changes. It makes sense, because then you're gonna see you have, you know, 25 different versions of one file with no notes, and you're thinking, what do I get? You know, I mean, like, what do I get? And it will cost you time. It will cost you a lot of time. So be clean. Running the team. I was taking care of some people in one outsourcing studio in Thailand 2 years back, and it was about 10 artists, all local people, so it was culturally homogenous, and I had to understand how things work, right? Like, for example, Thais, they don't really compete with each other too much. They're very kind. So, at the end of the first month, I understood that if I choose the correct person, the correct artist to talk to, I'll be sure that he goes around and spread the word, right? Which is very good. The help. I'm only, you know, mentioning this because teams, you know, come in all sorts of, you know, sizes and colors, cultures, if you want to, you know, take care of one, you better, you know, pay a very good attention to all, you know, artists, all individuals, because everyone is completely different. And if you approach them, you know, based on their own nature, sometimes you will be amazed, you know, what will happen, you know, how great of a change, you know, you can have. This one dude was probably junior, very silent, very, you know, he kept to himself all this time, and he only needed a really small push. Some information, some mentoring, and he took off, you know, like a rocket. So, don't be kind to people. Just try to understand where they come from. What are their skills? What they like to do, and go for them, right? Because sometimes you will be amazed. It's really great experience. Well, final remarks. All right. Final remarks. Don't do any unnecessary work. If you can buy assets from the asset store and tweak it to your, to your needs, do that. If you do that so far, if you have your artist do that so far, it will cost you five times more use your artists wisely for original pieces. Use their creativity. I mean, after all, that's what you have them for. Nowadays, with modern technologies, we don't really need to do this kind of boring, unnecessary work. Just do something creative and buy whatever you can. I mean, you can do that, but if you're going for some heavily stylized visuals, but that is fun to do by itself. So that's not a problem. And let's see. One last remark. If your budget's low, don't go for photo realistic visuals. Because, it will cost you way too much money. I mean, PBR, physically based rendering, is expensive. And the fidelity that you will be going for is just orbitally expensive. Be clever. Go for attraction, go for some nice style, go for something new that will attract people. It doesn't have to be complex. It has to be clever. It has to work with people. The thing with art is that like music, everyone, even if they're not professional, they understand quality. Because quality is a thing of feeling, of senses. So if you can hit that spot, you're actually helpful in there. One kind lady advised me yesterday that you're about to finish with a picture of Kat. So I thank you for your attention. If you have any questions, or want to start throwing tomatoes or whatever, now is the time.